family. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. He's the one we're living for. Let the answer be of this family. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
Because of COVID and everything we've been through, there's been this like dropping of anchors. We're in fear, we're discouraged. We dropped anchors just to find some kind of stability. It's time to pull the anchors up. Jesus says, those who are born of the Spirit and move with the Spirit are like those blown by the wind. The only way that we can move with the Spirit is to put our sails up. We want to cultivate a movement of healthy churches. This is not a top-down leadership model. This is a everybody has the power and the authority and is in charge model.
We set a goal this year of increasing the family by 3, and God gave us 4.
So 4 years ago, I stood in the front of our church in Grace Marietta, and the family of churches prayed over us, commissioned us. The elders of the family laid hands on us, and it was this just beautiful, beautiful moment for us, and we want you guys to experience that same moment.
Spirit will come upon you, and you will be seized with power.
May you leave this place acquainted with and accosted by the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. May you rise to the challenge, daring to question and change the status quo.
Snellville this morning. We are so glad that you're with us. Why don't you stand with us for worship? We can put our hands together this morning. We're going to celebrate a little bit about the trust that we have in the Lord, that He's good in every moment. Let's sing this together.
What a fellowship. What a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. I'm leaning pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arms. I'm
to Grace this morning. This is a place where we trust in the Lord, where we lean not on our own understanding, but in all of our ways acknowledge the Lord. And this morning, let's acknowledge the Lord in this place. Let's acknowledge the Lord in His goodness, in His kindness, in His justice, in His salvation. And let's just acknowledge that we need Him. Where is that place of poverty in your life? Where is that place of neediness in your life where we need to depend on Him? We've been singing this song for a few weeks now. It's just an invitation to come to the Lord's table, to posture your heart in a place of dependence and recognize surrender is a beautiful thing. Surrender is a really beautiful thing in the kingdom. Let's sing this together.
You send an invitation, all people dine with me. Hungry with desperation, this is my offering. I bring an exaltation, I praise you with my name. Heart full of expectation, this is my offering. Got a reason to sing, I got a reason to bring my praise. You're better than I believe, oh, you're changing me. I got a reason to sing, I got a reason to bring my praise. You're better than I believe, oh, you're changing me. Oh, you're changing me. Thank you. give you all of my pain. I got nothing to lose, but I got plenty to gain. I give you prayer as an offering. You delight in all I bring. I got nothing to lose, but I got plenty to gain. Give you all of my hope. I give you all of my pain. I got nothing to lose, but I got plenty to gain. Every prayer is an offering. You delight in all I bring. I got a reason to sing. I got a reason to bring my praise. You're better than I believe. Oh, you change. Plenty to gain. Every prayer is an offering. You delight in all I bring. I got a reason to sing. Got a reason to bring my praise. You're better than I believe. Oh, you're changing me. I got a reason to sing. I got a reason to bring my praise. You're better than I believe. You're changing me. Oh, you're changing me.
And Lord, this is our prayer this morning, that you would change us. If we are in your presence, we just expect, we want to be changed by you. To not just be changed in our head with knowledge, but to be changed in our heart with how we live our lives. So this morning, Lord, we just acknowledge you. We welcome you into this place. Whatever we have to give, we bring that to you in dependence, Lord, and surrender. We love you. It's in your name. Amen. Amen. You guys can have a seat. I want to invite Kamal up to the stage. And as he's coming, real quick, I just wanted to acknowledge and honor one of my good friends, one of my dear friends who's been working with me over the last number of years. You never really see him because he's never on a stage, but he makes everything work in our auditorium. He's done such an amazing job of innovating and making this space work more efficiently and effectively. And Michael Howard's last Sunday is this Sunday. He's right there in the back. Can we just give him a round of applause? Yeah. Michael's going to be moving to Birmingham to be closer to some extended family. He and his family, Steph, and their two kids, they've just been a joy and just a delight to be around. And Michael, we love you. This is home for you. And we just are so thankful for in the ways that you've served. So thank you so much, man. Bless you.
Yeah, you can give it up for Michael one more time. Thanks, David. I just love that second song. Guys, my name is Kamal. It's good to be with you this morning. And if you're watching online, welcome. Glad you're joining us in the virtual space as well. So you guys know me because I served as a missions pastor for about 3 years here, and I just recently made the transition to leading the student team at Grace, and that's my full-time responsibility, working in the middle school and the high school spaces. So I'm excited about that, but you know, if you've been driving past Grace, you know, I've had some conversations with people in the community, and they're asking, like, what are those tables outside in front of Grace? And I'm like, you just got to come to one of the parties. That's where you find out, right? That's where you find out. But, you know, our heart this summer is to reconnect community one conversation at a time, because we're coming out of COVID, coming out of time where maybe I've been social distancing, I've been isolated, I've been alone. And the best way to do that is just to have a conversation, to figure out what that table space is for you. When we talk about table space, right, the reason we have those tables outside is because we believe, like, there should be people at your table, right? People that you are in consistent community with. And so that could be your family, your dinner table on Sunday night or Monday or throughout the course of the week. It could be the pool swim meet. It could be time with your extended family. But those spaces, you know, everybody needs them. And we're going to reconnect this summer, one conversation at a time. All right. I feel like I need to say, let's get ready to rumble, because Lee Lopez is preaching tonight. I want to welcome Lee up here. And Lee and I go way back. And Lee, I just appreciate your heart for the Lord. I just want to pray for you this morning. As you preach.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, Lord, I just thanks for Lee, and I just thanks for Sophia and Savannah. And I ask that just words that come from his mouth, God, would just be your words. And Lord, what we need to understand from this passage that Lee's teaching on from the letters to the churches would just open our mind. Lord, how can we be a real church, God? That if you were to write a letter to us, God, it would be the right kind of letter, God. Help us to learn what we need to learn. And we just thank you, Lord, to bless him right now. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, church, continuing the legacy of the man of God, if you don't have a Bible, would you please raise your hand and one will be handed to you. And if you do have your Bible, you get extra points. And I'm just kidding. Open it up to the book of Revelation as we continue this series on the seven churches, chapter 3, Revelation chapter 3, verse 7. Revelation chapter 3, verse 7. We are going to be speaking on what Jesus says to the church of Philadelphia. And as we were worshiping earlier today, I just was reminiscing and thinking and, you know, just worshiping God. And I remember being 24 and being in a Saturday meeting, I believe it was, and right there in that front row. And Buddy was speaking about Jen Salam. And I remember we started worshiping, and at this moment, I was a biology student. In my mind, the future was medical school, and as I was worshiping, I remember just the randomness of thought. One day, you're going to be up there. I was like, Lord, what? I'm over here trying to worship you, God. Why are you talking about one day I'm going to be up there? It's like, no, one day I'm going to have you up there. And I was like, okay, when I go out and serve you out in, you know, the mission field and heal people and, you know, do all that. And I didn't get that peace. I just kept hearing one day you're going to be up there. And, you know, the doors that God has opened, no man can shut. And I'm here as a testimony that when God wills it, it will come to pass. Amen. And I can't start this passage without praising him, because I've seen too much good in my life. I've seen him open the doors, make a way where there was no way. I've seen him work on my behalf. I've seen him take a shy, nervous, shaking young man that wouldn't dare to come up and speak to anyone and just empower me with his Holy Spirit. And so this passage is a personal passage to me. It's not just another passage, but this is a passage that has encouraged me through the years. And I hope that as I read, a promise of God would be birthed into your heart. Verse 7, to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these are the words of him who is holy and true. Holy, completely separate. There is no one like him and true. Unwavering, you can be trusted. He is the one who holds the key of David. What he opens, no one can shut. And what he shuts, no one can open. I know your deeds. See, I have placed before you an open door that no one can shut. I know that you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. I will make those who are of the synagogue of Satan, who claim to be Jews, though they are not, but are liars, I will make them come and fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I have loved you. Since you have kept my command to endure patiently, I will also keep you from the hour of trial that is going to come on the whole world to test the inhabitants of the earth. I'm coming soon. Hold on to what you have so that no one will take your crown. The one who is victorious, I will make a pillar in the temple of my God. Never again will they leave it. I will write on them the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem, which is coming down out of heaven from my God. And I will also write on them my new name. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. I love that Revelation is more than just a book about end times. It's more than just a book about apocalyptic disaster, or more than just how God is going to judge the entire earth. But we can see the heart of Revelation by the beginning of the letter. It is a way of Jesus expressing his heart to his church. A church that is going through a lot of things. A church that is going through persecution. A church that is going through rejection. A church that is going through so many things that we can't comprehend. And through this book, he reveals his heart for the church. Some churches he rebukes, but specifically two of them, the church of Smyrna and the church of Philadelphia, he strongly encourages, for they have been faithful. Now let's go back and talk about the church of Philadelphia. The church of Philadelphia is in the city of Philadelphia, and this city was established by Eumenes II. Philadelphia is a compound word, and it's a Greek word from philos, which means love, and adelphos, which means brother. And so this city is the city of brotherly love. It was a prosperous city. It was a major city, for it was in between major regions of the world. If you wanted to go to the east, you had to go through Philadelphia. And because of its location, its people felt like they had a special task. They were cultural missionaries. They felt like they had the task of replicating and colonizing the rest of the world, the rest of the East, into Greek culture. they were actually known as the door to the east. If you wanted to travel eastward, you had to pass through Philadelphia. And they were known as the door to the east. So enamored with culture, Greek culture were they, that the ancient historian Strabo called them Little Athens. One, because how tightly they adhered to the culture, but also because they were a beautiful, beautiful city. But in 17 AD, an earthquake occurred that completely destroyed the entire city. Now, so bad was the earthquake that the Romans, the government in Rome, decided to exempt the city of Philadelphia from taxes for 5 years. Now, this is unheard of. Rome does not do this. They tax everybody. They're Uncle Sam's. But they were destroyed so badly that they were exempt from taxes for 5 years. And so the population that lived in the city is forced to move out of the city. And they start living and making little homes outside of the city. The only thing that remained after this horrible earthquake, even till this day, were the strongest pillars. And we have a picture of these pillars. Even till this day, these pillars are there. And what would happen was that the city was rebuilt. And these were the pillars that were made in order for the city not to be destroyed once again. And I don't know if you're catching this, but in the passage, Jesus picks up certain themes of the culture within Philadelphia. He says, I will make you a pillar in the house of my God where you will never have to leave. There will be no earthquake that will get you in the house of my God. You will be strong and stable. You will never have to leave the city of my God, the New Jerusalem. And this is the way that Jesus encourages his people. Aren't you glad that you have a God that's not going to use the story of Juan, Pedro, Jeremy, or whoever else? He's going to speak directly to your situation. You see, so many times we miss God because we don't have a relationship where we believe that he can speak into our very situation. We think that he's going to work the way he worked with Buddy or the way he worked with John or the way he worked with Matt. No, I'm a different individual with a different plan, and that's okay. If he wanted Matt to do it, he would have chosen Matt. If he wanted Peter to do it, he would have chosen Peter. But he's chosen you and me. Oh, and what God has for you, there's no man, no power, no demon, no authority in heaven or hell that can take it away from us. And this is why I am so excited about this passage, because this passage tells us that there's a door that God opens for our life that no one can shut. And so this people, the people of God, are in this city that has just been destroyed. And as the city begins to build up again, they begin to be kicked out of the synagogues. Now, why is that important? We must remember that at the beginning of Christianity, Christianity was very connected to Judaism. Matter of fact, they were considered a sect of Judaism. But the Christians were different. They were a little bit more passionate. And they did not want to adhere to human customs. And they were geared towards evangelism. And what happens is that the Christians began to multiply in the synagogues, and the Jewish authorities began to say, wait, hold on, wait a minute. We ain't going to have none of that in this church. But the Christian says, well, look, this is what we're going to continue to do. We're going to continue to go for the neglected. We're going to continue to go for the poor. We're going to continue to go for those who are different than us. And we're going to continue to proclaim that Jesus Christ is the Messiah. But the Jewish authorities were not having that. That's not orderly. That's just not right. And they started kicking them out of the synagogue. The other thing we must understand, and we must go back into history, the Jewish people who would go in these cities were persecuted for many years. And so they would go and inhabit different cities like Philadelphia, Sardis. And throughout this whole series, you're going to hear about Jewish people in these cities because they were persecuted and they would go and establish synagogues in all these cities. Now, after Rome kind of settled down with them because they were rowdy people, they made an agreement. And the agreement was that the Jewish people did not have to proclaim that Caesar was Lord, because they would go to war year after year before they did that. And so Rome said, okay, let's have some peace. And this is what we're going to do. At every synagogue, we are going to have a registry. And every name that is in the registry of the synagogue, we are going to exempt from proclaiming that Caesar is Lord. You just got to pay your taxes. But we're going to exempt you from saying Caesar is Lord. And so what happened was that the leaders of the synagogue, as they began to see the growth of Christianity, started pushing the Christians out and started claiming that it was because of the Christians and their pagan ways that the city was destroyed. It was because of the Christians that famines were going on. It was because of the Christians that the taxes were coming in. It was because of the Christians that everything that went wrong in the city was happening. And because they were no longer in this registry, now their life began to be in danger. Not only that, they were excluded from this social center that was the synagogue. They were excluded by friends. They were excluded by family. They were neglected. And what happens to this church in Philadelphia is that they become little in numbers. The passage tells us that they're little in power, but really that is a phrase to explain that they had a little bit of people. It wasn't much. There were a few of them. But you know, the reason why God says, I'm proud of you, is that they were a few, but they had a big faith. They were small, but they believed big. They knew who their God was. And so this people who were a few, this people who were neglected, this people who were pushed out, this people who didn't have anything anymore, this people that lost their city were now out in the outskirts of the city trying to praise God, trying to bring God into the city and outside of the city. They were missionaries. They were trying to reach out the east. And you see, I think it's hard for a lot of us to understand what it means to not have what these people didn't have, which was something to call a home, something to go and worship, a place to go and worship. Because we have grown with hundreds of churches around us. We've always had a home. But I remember when we first came to the United States and we lived with a pastor. He was from Honduras, and he allowed us to have one of their rooms in the basement. And it was the smallest room in the house, and it fit four people. It was me, my dad, my sister, and I. It was tiny. Someone, out of the goodness of their heart, gave us a bunk bed, and I remember sleeping in the top of the bunk bed, and my parents and my sister all sardine at the bottom. It was a good, those were good times, for me at least. But I remember being like, whoa, I mean, the living room was right there, the changing room was right there, the bunk bed was right here. We had no room. I was like, are we gonna run out of oxygen in this place? No room. But I had fun because I was with my parents. Now, breakfast was weird. I remember I was a very, very energetic young man. And I remember waking up in the mornings and my parents be like, don't wake them up. We already have enough problems as it is, you know. And I remember tiptoeing into the bathroom and like just, you know, doing this whole deal. But I had so much energy. I was 9. No, I had just turned 10. And I had so much energy. And breakfasts were weird because I had to be so completely silent. And I remember that they would always tell us, hey, you can come and hang out with us for breakfast at the breakfast table. And they would have something that we didn't have in Honduras called waffles. And I remember they put the waffles in this machine that I've never seen, and it popped out. And so they always would ask me, do you want some waffles? And I said, do I? They would put the waffles in the middle, and I would take one, you know, being shy. And they said, don't be shy. Get some. After 20... they were just looking at me weird. But it was good for the first week. I was eating waffles left and right. I gained a lot of weight. But by the third week, it's like I was getting waffles and I could just feel laser eyes, judgment. It was just shifting. The atmosphere was changing. It was 6 months, and after several conversations with my parents, they said, we can't do this anymore. My daughter wants her room back, and you guys have to go. My mom didn't have a job. My dad was working part-time. I don't believe we had $500 to our name. But I do remember that late July, sunny day, in just the cold, heart-wrenching, nauseating feeling of being rejected. I remember not having anything. And this is what the Christians in the Church of Philadelphia were going through. And God says, oida, in Greek, I know, I see, I am aware. Not by something I heard, I have seen it myself. I know your deeds. I know your desperation. I know your heartache. And behold, now that word is one of my favorite words in Greek. It's translated as behold, or maybe in your Bible it's see, or maybe it's lo, which I don't understand what lo means, but see, behold. The best translation that my professor said to me was, this is translated to, wow, wow, wow. Look at what I'm about to do. He sees your situation. He sees your pain. He sees when there isn't a check coming in, when you can't make ends meet. He sees when your child has gone astray. He sees all these things and he says, behold, behold, wow, 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 look at what I'm about to do. I am about to open a door that no man can shut. I am about to do something that no ear has heard or no eyes has seen. Or has it entered to the mind of men? I am about to do something in your life so big that you're not going to have room enough to withhold. That is the God we serve. And you see, the important fact here is that not the blessing, not the open door, but the fact that they were connected to the key holder. The fact that they were connected to the one who holds the key of David, which means I have authority over the house of Israel. So therefore, those Jewish authorities that they're kicking you out, that they're rejecting you, I will humiliate them and make them kneel down, the word says, and acknowledge that I have loved you. Whew. I want Jesus to do that to some of my enemies. Praise the Lord. It's in the word. It's not an evil thought from myself. Sometimes, you know, the word says he will knock their teeth out. And sometimes I pray that at night and then I repent in the morning. But this is, these Christians had no home, no place of worship. They were alienated, betrayed by the authorities. Their life was in danger. They were excluded. They were accused. But God says, I have an open door. What does that tell me? I cannot live my life by what I see. I cannot live my life by what others see about me. I gotta live my life trusting that there's a key holder that holds the doors and will open when they need to be open for the destiny of my life. Do you believe that this morning? I tell you what, if we believe that, we would praise God every time we come together. We would be excited about God because he's doing something behind the scenes. God does his best work behind the scenes. Amen? When we don't know, when we're doubting and we're trying to figure it out, he's working. That's the God I serve. That's the God I want to serve. The God who holds the keys. He holds the keys to life and death. He holds the keys to knowledge. He holds the keys to life. He has the key to every door. To Moses, he had the key. As he was going down the river, he had the key to the palace. To Israel, he had the key to the Red Sea. To the people of Israel, he had the key to the victory and gaining the promised land. To Balaam, he had the key to shut his mouth and only speak blessing while he wanted to bring cursing. He has the key when people are looking to speak evil about you. He has the key to turn it around and bless your life. Oh man, I want to serve the key holder. Do you know the key holder this morning? He has the key to the three young men who were in the fire but got out. He has the key to the cave in the lion's den when Daniel got out. He has the key when the tomb tried to keep him in. He had the key out of the tomb, out of death, and he's alive this morning. So give him some praise. You serve a God that is alive. The key of life, the key of truth is within his hand. Stop searching it at the lake. Stop searching for it through the cars and the houses and this material stuff. You are going to be deeply disappointed. But if you want to find life, but if you want to find life in abundance, there's one that holds the key. And his name is Jesus. And the church of Philadelphia knew the key holder. You see, in my journey, I've learned that open doors are amazing, but open doors don't eliminate doubt. Bigger yet, open doors don't eliminate doubters. So do not be amazed when it gets a little hard. Do not be perplexed when other people don't believe it or can't see it or don't agree with it. Do not be amazed when you have to endure. Because sometimes God will for our life is to endure. And when things get hard, when things get difficult, it doesn't mean that it's not the will of God for our life. Oh, marriage is hard. Parenting is hard. Yeah. Doing the right thing is hard. Purity is hard. Love is hard. Forgiveness is hard. Just because something is hard, it doesn't cease to be the will of God. And if someone brings you any other gospel, Jesus said that we had to carry our cross. So when it gets hard, keep fighting. Keep getting up. Keep coming back. Keep trying. Keep loving. Keep serving. Keep believing, keep the faith, for his word says, and God is no man that he would lie. He says, do not get weary of doing good, for in due season, you will reap if you do not stop. Galatians 6, 9. Tattoo it in your body if you want to. In due time. In due time. That is the message to the church of Philadelphia. In due time, I've seen your works. You are little, but you have a mighty faith. In due time, and when that time comes, I'm going to make you a pillar in the house of my God. A pillar signifies something unshakable, something strong, something that people go to. In due time, when you endure patiently, when you endure patiently, that's the mispractice of Christianity in this 21st century, enduring patiently. As soon as something doesn't look like we thought it would look, we run. But when you endure patiently, I will make you a pillar in the house of my God. So I'm here to tell somebody, keep enduring and keep being patient. Keep fighting. Keep believing. He's not done with you yet. If you're breathing, if you're in this room, if you're watching online, he's not done with you yet. And he has an open door for you if you are willing to hold the hand of the key holder. He says, hold on. I have no idea how much time I have left. But I want to show you a video. So that's a video of our family trip over to the national parks in Utah. And I promise Sophia was happy. She didn't look like it in the videos. And Sophia is my two-year-old. And it's just different over there. And when I had to take the hikes in order for Sophia to come, and this was her first trip with us, I had to get this blue, I don't even know what it was, but like a blue instrument in the back of my, in my shoulders. And Sophia weighs 42 going on 72. And the elevation everywhere we went was way higher than the elevation here in Georgia. Now, I can't take the elevation here in Georgia. And so when I was in Utah, I was in severe problems. But as I was carrying her, and at first I was like, okay, let's see. Lord, I can do all things through you who strengthen me. But you know what started to happen? People started to say, Father of the Year, the Chuck Norris of hiking. Oh, Father of Fathers. You know, Diego the Explorer. I'm not lying. All those came out of somebody's mouth. Like the Rambo of hiking and all this stuff, right? And I was like, yeah. Woo. But then you reach a point where it's just inclined. And actually, that's where most people started saying stuff to me. And it was hard. I was breathing heavy. I was like, okay. It's one thing going through life in the hard places without anything in your back. But it's another thing when you must carry a load. In the Church of Philadelphia, was seen as faithful because they were carrying a load. Paul uses a word, more than conquerors. And this word is rooted to an Olympic game where the athlete would go all the way to the top of the mountain. And at the top of the mountain, they would say, good job, you are a conqueror. And they would come down through the slopes and they would pick up a load. And they would have to go up all the way to the top. And once they reached the top, they gained the title of being more than a conqueror. Some of you are carrying the loads of your family, the load of your children, the load of not knowing what the future holds, the load of a business, the load of failed past. But there's someone that can help you with that. And in some instances, we need to let that load go. But in others, we need to put our belt on and we need to keep going. And in due time, God will show up. In due time, He will show us what He was working along this whole time. This is what I've learned from this journey, being over there at Lake Lanier. I was so focused on the destination that I didn't see the key holder. But as soon as I grabbed his hand He began to open doors that I couldn't. And he began to make a way where there is none. So no longer does it matter the destination. I'm going to praise him in the beginning. There's been times that it's been 20 of us. But I praised him just as much as I praise him today with 400 or however many people there are here. Because I got hold of the key holder's hand. And I know he will continue to open doors. And I believe that for your life as well. So this morning, it is a choice that you have to make. Will you hold on to his hand, or will you be preoccupied with the destination? He's got the key to the doors of your destiny. Amen? Father God, we praise you and thank you because you hold the keys to life. We don't have to be worried. Your word says we don't have to be anxious. You got this. And so this morning, we just want to lay it down in your altar and praise your name. When things are bad and when things are good and when things are medium, we just want to praise your name because we know you are working on our behalf. And what the enemy meant for evil, you will turn it around and make it for our good. That is your promise. So speak to us this morning and show us your open doors. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And let his church say, amen.
Amen. Stand and worship. Turn our hearts to Jesus, the one who's faithful and true. The one who's established covenant with his people.
You're the God of Abraham, you're the God of covenant, of faithful promises. Time and time again, you have proven, do just what you said. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I remain steadfast, and I'll let my heart learn to speak your word. It will come to pass. Great is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun till the sunny same, I will praise you.
You've closed the doors to my past that no one can open. From the rising sun to the setting, same, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me. Oh, we worship you, Lord. I still bless you. I still bless you. I put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground, my hope and firm foundation. He'll never let me down. I put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground, my hope and firm foundation.
This morning, as we sing this last song, church, I just want to invite you, if you need to lay down the load that you've been carrying, maybe an outward posture looks like you coming forward to kneel down at the stairs, maybe laying down what you're not meant to carry means that you go and receive prayer on the wings to my right and to my left, as people will be there to pray with you. If picking up what you need to pick up, God's calling you to pick something up that you haven't for a while. Let's express gratitude and thankfulness for all that he is doing, for all that he's given. Maybe this morning there's prepared works that he's set before you that you haven't picked up yet. Maybe he's calling you to do that this morning. Just invite you in gratitude to lay down and to pick up.
Is clear to see. It's constant every day. In the morning, you sing over me, and I receive your mercy.
You receive your mercy, Lord.
Your faithfulness is clear to see. To believe you are creating something good, though the season doesn't tell my story.
So as we end, would you extend your hands in a posture of receiving? Now, Lord, would you give us eyes to see the wow, wow,
Wow. The door that you have opened for us. And when it gets difficult and tough, would you give us the discipline to endure patiently? To know the difference of the loads we must put down and the loads we must pick up. Would you make us as strong and unshakable as pillars in your house? In the name of Jesus, amen. You are dismissed.
Let you bring, and when you walk into the room, every heart starts burning, and nothing matters more than just to sit here at your feet and worship you. Starts to vanish, every hopeless situation ceases.